Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established grant schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. The Memphis branch was established in 1973. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. This has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word, our Son, is Elohim. This has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. This has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1600 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We've drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Yahweh Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having in the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine vision and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel up out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consisted of a most holy place, and court roundabout. These three compartments making up the one tabernacle pattern. We go about in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and the function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. We have 10 primary aims or constitution objectives of the Institute, and they are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sect, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, a so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, both modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth, to escape current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained. There is none other name under heaven given among men whereby man can be saved, saving in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Slogan, speak the truth. We'll have prayer by Dr. Olivia Dobbins. Our scripture lesson for today will be 2 Samuel, the 6th chapter, read by Dr. Catherine Smith.
Good morning.
Morning.
Let's bow our hearts and minds for a moment of supplication unto Yahweh. Heavenly Father Yahweh, a few of your servants have come together. You have held servants across this country and across this world who have continued in the path that you have set before us. You came and you brought us the glorious evangel of salvation, which only lies in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us continue to preach with fervent fire. Let us always hold you foremost in our hearts and in our minds. Keep us steadfast and unmovable in this faith, because salvation alone is in Yahshua the Messiah, as you have set forth from the foundation of the world. All these things we ask in the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'll be reading to you from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer of the Scripture Research Association. This is the 2012 edition of the Holy Name Bible, reprinted by Yahshua's Promotion. 2 Samuel 6 chapter, page 399. Again, David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from the Baals of Judah to bring up from thence the ark of Elohim, whose name is called by the name of Yahweh of hosts, that dwelleth between the cherubs. And they set the ark of Elohim upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, that was in Gibeah. And Uzzah and Ahoah, the sons of Abinadab, drave the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeah, accompanying the ark of Elohim. And Ahoah went before the ark. And David and all the house of Israel played before Yahweh on all manner of instruments, made of fir wood, even on harps, and on psalteries, and on timbrels, and on cornets and cymbals. And when they came to Nashon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of Elohim, and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. And the anger of Yahweh was kindled against Uzzah, and Elohim smote him there for his rashness, and there he died by the ark of Elohim. And David was displeased because Yahweh had made a breach upon Uzzah. And he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of Yahweh that day and said, "How shall the ark of Yahweh come to me?" So David would not remove the ark of Yahweh unto him into the city of David. But David carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And the ark of Yahweh continued in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And Yahweh blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David, saying, "Yahweh hath blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him because of the ark of Elohim." So David went and brought up the ark of Elohim from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. And it was so that when they that bare the ark of Yahweh had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings. And David danced before Yahweh with all his might, and David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of Yahweh with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. And as the ark of Yahweh came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and dancing before Yahweh, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought in the ark of Yahweh and set it in his place in the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offering and peace offering before Yahweh. And as soon as David had made an end of offering burnt offerings and peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of Yahweh of hosts. And he dealt among all the people, even among the whole multitude of Israel, as well as to the women as men, to every one a cake of bread and a good piece of flesh and a flagon of wine. So all the people departed, every one to his house. Then David returned to bless his household. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, "How glorious was the king of Israel today, who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaids of his servants, as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovereth himself." And David said unto Michal, "It was before Yahweh, which chose me before thy father and before all his house, to appoint me ruler over the people of Yahweh, over Israel. Therefore will I play before Yahweh, and I will yet be more humble than thus, and will be base in mine own sight. And of the maidservants which thou hast spoken of them shall I be had in honor. Shall I be had in honor. Therefore, Michelle, the daughter of Saul, had no child unto the day of her death. 2 Samuel 6 chapter from the Holy Name Version of the Bible. Let the body say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay. I'd like to say good morning to the class. I've asked to be the first speaker this morning, but I'm thankful to Yahweh through his son Yahshua for him even giving me anything to say concerning him. And in reading the scripture and how David danced before Yahweh and rejoiced before Yahweh. And that's what we was talking about, you know, is rejoicing for the goodness of Yahweh that he have given unto us. A lot of times we look at what we only calling on him when we in trouble and, you know, we all bowed and all this and other stuff and we under some kind of pressure. But it's just like I was sharing with the vessel some time ago. I said, do you remember? When they was complaining and going on, I said, but do you remember? I said, when Yahweh delivered you out of this. Do you remember when Yahweh through his son Yahshua delivered you out of this? And so we had to walk back down memory lane. And finally they said, oh yeah, and I remember this. You know, then they helped me out with the story because they had rehearsed it to me how that Yahshua had delivered them. I said, but now, here you go, moaning and groaning. I said, but can you wait? Can you wait on, you know, the salvation of Yahshua? And what I was looking at is how that they blew trumpets and everything. You know, they beat on the harps and they sang and they gave the praises to Yahweh. Well, one of the things that we have been made to see, know, and understand here in this school is that there is a way to come to a knowledge and understanding of our Creator, the way he really is and the way he actually exists. And what we want to do, Yahshua willing, is just to go back and share some things with you and show you how the Yahweh got this thing tight. I mean, it's so consistent that every time you go and find a principle or something that comes up, then he's going to bring forth more and more. The vessel was talking about how, you know, asking vessels to get up and use the pointer and said, now if you make one step, Yahshua, he'll make the other. Just get up there and point, you know. So it's just something to want to share this teaching. Now, one of the things that we want to share with you is how when Yahshua, this was the third day, and we're going to use this chart right here. So, you know, if you have where you can actually see, because these charts is just not up here just to be hanging up here, but to use the chart to point. So when you go away or go home, you will have a picture in your heart and in your mind of something that illustration that you they say a picture's worth a thousand words. So we want you to look at this picture here and what it's picking up. We're over here and what we're using is the Bible. And this is the Bible in pictorial form that came, and all the charts that you see here, the founder of this organization, Dr. Henry C. Kelly, in 1931, had a stupendous divine panoramic vision. And this is what he saw. So this is what he has brought forth for us. And he tells us to be mindful that these are our teaching aids or tools to help us to understand the self-same vision that he saw, or to eat of the same food that he ate, you know. And that's what this is, and what you have, all these charts are on plates. And so what you're looking at is something set before you, and what we're going to do is that we're going to go right here. Now this scripture here, we're going to use Luke, the 24th chapter, and you find these two here walking. They are on the road to Emmaus. And this is the third day since Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection. This was the third day, resurrection day, that they are walking along on the road to Emmaus.
And you pick that up in Luke 24 and 21. And you're going to, and they're going to just, I want them to.
Luke 21.
Read, please.
But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel.
Uh-huh.
And besides all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yea. And certain women also of our company made us astonished.
Read.
Which were early at the sepulcher.
They were early at the sepulcher. Read.
And when they found not his body.
They found not his body. So we're not talking about Yahshua the Messiah in this physical body. We're talking about him. This is third day. This is resurrection day. And you can pick it up in another scripture over there where it talks about how he appeared unto them in another form. So what you have is that Yahshua joining himself unto these two on the road to Emmaus. And what they're talking about, yeah, you know, he had said he must go to Jerusalem and he was going to be spitefully mistreated and then he was going to be killed. Well, all those things happened. And they said, and now, today is the third day since these things were done. So then he has joined himself. When he joined himself unto them and he asked them, well, what manner of communication is this that you are having one with another as you walk and you're saying? And that's when they get the mouthing off about this the third day since these things were done. In other words, we ain't seen him. We haven't seen him, you know. So he says unto them, he said, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. He said, ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory. And he said, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. And in the 44th verse, he says what? Read, please.
And he said unto them,
these are the words. These are the words. Words. Read.
Which I spake unto you.
While I was yet with while you. Now I spoke some things to you while I was walking around in this physical body before I went through this death, burial, resurrection. Read.
That all things.
Now he didn't say, well, some things I'm going to do and some things I'm going to leave out. No. He said that all things, read.
Must be fulfilled.
They must be fulfilled, read.
Which were written in the law of Moses.
So he takes them, now when you look up here on this chart right here it says pattern or plan. And it got law and testimony, or law and the prophets. And he says what, read.
These are the words which I spake with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses.
In the law of Moses. So you got five books. So you got five books of the law. And he said, now he's talking about the law of Moses. Read.
And in the prophets. And in the Psalms. Concerning me.
Now, if you go in and you take your Bible, And you look at how the Bible is actually even put together. Now he says go back to the law, which would put you, the first five books of the Bible, you open your Bible, you got Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Now, that's five books. That's the law, okay? Now he says, he's expounding unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And he said the law, and then he said the prophets. So then you come over to Joshua, which starts what? The prophets. And you're going to pick up, and the sum. So you're going to pick up 34 books. 34 books. So 5 plus 34 would be 39 books. So then he says what? Lo, I come in the what? In the volume of the book. So he's teaching them and showing them that they have to go back and begin at Moses in order for them to understand what he's even speaking of. And so he even tells them that in John 5:39. This, now, he's telling them something after this. And now we want to see, well, what did he tell them before he went through this? Now in John 5:39, it says, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. He said, but they are they which testify of me. So if you got him telling them before and after, it's the same thing. The same thing he told them before, then it's the same thing he's reiterating to them. And he went on to tell them how that he came in to fulfill. Okay? He said, think not that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not the law or the prophets. Now those are his witnesses, his two witnesses. So now he said the law and the prophets. He said, so don't think I come to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy them, but to fulfill. In other words, I'm going to satisfy the requirement. I'm going to move that thing out of the way, okay? So he said, go back and begin at Moses. Well, why we got to go to Moses? Over there in Psalms 103:7, it says, he made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. So if we want to know anything about him, the arrow is steady pointing us back. We got to go back and begin at Moses. So what we're doing is he's laying a foundation for us to come to a knowledge and understanding of him. In Isaiah 8:20, it says, to the law, there it is again, and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, who is Yahweh Elohim, it says it is because there is no light or there is no understanding in them. So we want to be obedient and go back here to the law. Now, back here in the law of Moses, and what you have is that the scripture lesson came off talking about how they blew the trumpets and everything. Well, I just would like to share with the class about how Yahweh, after he brought the children of Israel up out of the land of Egypt, to and through dividing waters of the Red Sea, out here in the wilderness, he gave them laws and statutes and judgments and commandments that they would do them. And he also gave them, and what you have is over here in, I just want to pick up over here, I think in Deuteronomy, when he was telling them about making a trumpet. And he told them, he said, now you make this trumpet, he said, because, in other words, it's like you got the sounding of the assembly. I think it's, I want to be sure, let me see. Because the whole thing is he was telling them, he even told them before you got to Deuteronomy, but I don't want to be long, but I do want to share this, because he said, now you make trumpets, and what you do is, the trumpets was for the calling of the assembly. And when you pick up them blowing the trumpets, he said, now, but the one is, I can't find the scripture right now, but Yahshua willing, hopefully we'll find it. But he told them, he said, when you blow for the gathering together of the assembly, you're going to sound this trumpet. Well, the trumpet had more than one sound. It had a time of the calling of the assembly. It had a time of going forth to war. It had the ones who would get up first, who was gathered around this tabernacle. So the sounding of that trumpet had different uses. And when the trumpeter would sound it, then the people would know what to do.
Numbers 10.
Okay, so thank you. So we're going to go over here to Numbers, the 10th chapter. I think it's
We'll start at one.
Mm-hmm. Start at first verse. Read, please.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying. Read.
Make thee two trumpets.
Now he said make two trumpets. Read.
Of silver.
Uh-huh.
Of a whole piece.
Uh-huh.
Shalt thou make them.
Read, please.
That thou mayest use them for the calling of the assembly.
Now you're going to use these trumpets for the calling of the assembly. Read.
And for the journeying.
And for your journey. In other words, when that cloud would get up, then they had to get up and follow that cloud. So he says you're going to use them in your journeying. Read.
Of the camp.
Read, please.
And when they shall blow with them, all the assembly shall assemble themselves to thee.
Read, please.
At the door of the tabernacle.
At the door of the tabernacle, read.
Of the congregation.
Read, please.
And if they blow.
And if they blow. So now, this is, it's like you have to have instruction. And that's the thing what I think about so much with this class is that when I was brought in here, there was things prepared for me. They had a syllabus. You had your aims. You know, everything, by the time the first vessel would hit the floor, you had been toned down where you was able and put you in that I want to hear mode. Mm-hmm. There was some singing going on. There was the moderation that was going on. That was the prayer that went on. And when the prayer went on, you know, you toning, I mean, he bringing that old man on into subjection. Mm-hmm. Sit down and hear me. You know, and then there's the reading of the scripture. You know, and it's just beautiful to me. And what you have is, and then your food or your plate is set before you to eat. And that's what is going on up here. A plate have been set before you, and then a vessel, Yahshua through them would get up here, and they would labor going through these different charts and pointing at different things on the chart, and I would just be sitting there, and I would be looking, and I'd be sitting there, and by and by one day, I don't even know how it began to happen, but he gave me to do the moderation, and I stood up and did the moderation, and somebody said, well, when did you learn the moderation? I don't know. You know, but I was sitting in class. It's just like he's teaching me, and you don't even know that you're being taught. Mm-hmm. And then when he's standing you up, I mean, when you can really see that it's him that's standing you up to do this, you can say, I'm not going to do this. I don't want to do this. It's not about you. It's not about what I want to do. It's what Yahshua is going to use this vessel for, and he's going to do it according to his divine purpose, pattern, and plan, and there's nothing that you can do about it, you know. So he is telling them about this trumpet, and he said, make two of them. Why has it got to be two? Because out of the mouth of what? Two or more witness. He said, let every word be established. So you got the law and the prophets. What did the Lazarus over there tell when they said, the rich man died, Lazarus died. Lazarus being allegorical, he said, in Abraham's bosom or in heaven or in the holy place. Mm-hmm. And he going to tell him, Father Abraham, let Lazarus come and dip his finger in this water and cool my scorching tongue. Mm-hmm. He says, nay. He said, they have the law and the prophets. Let them hear them. Because if they won't hear the law and the prophets, neither will they hear if one came to them from the dead. Mm-hmm. And really, it was fixed because Lazarus, the souls of them that was under this altar, it said that, look, you can't come here and they can't come there. Mm-hmm. There's a great gulf. There's a great gulf. It's 70 feet. All the way here, 70 feet. That's bondage. You down here. You're bound. But he said, make me two silver trumpets. Read, please.
And if they blow with one trumpet.
If they blow with but one trumpet, read.
Then the princes,
which
are heads of the thousands of
read.
Israel,
read.
Shall gather themselves unto thee.
Read, please.
And when ye blow
an alarm, read.
Then the camp,
read,
that lie on the east part shall go forward.
And you know, he giving them instruction.
Right.
Read, please.
When ye blow an alarm the second time, then the camps that lie on the south side,
read,
shall take their journey.
They gonna take their journey. Read.
And they shall blow an alarm for their journeys.
Read, please.
But when the congregation.
Now listen, he said, but when the congregation, read,
is to be gathered together.
Is to be gathered together. We are having a coming together here, read.
Ye shall blow.
But ye shall not
sound an alarm.
It's not going to be an alarm. Well, what is the trumpets that sounding now? Mm-hmm. Come to class and learn about Yahweh Elohim Yahshua. Come, eat, drink. What is over there say about wine without price, without money? Eat to the full. Well, what are you eating? You have all these different plates. And each one of these plates have something on here. Mm-hmm. And it's going according to this divine pattern that Yahweh Elohim gave to Moses up here in Mount Sinai. And that's when the moderation is being done. And it says how Yahweh took Moses up here and showed him this threefold intangible tabernacle pattern. And said, look at it. Look, Moses, that you make one. What? Just like the one that I showed you in the mount down here in the wilderness. And again, you know, when you listen and you listen at the blowing of the trumpet. So you're back here with Moses and with the blowing of the trumpet, right? So then when you come over over in the book of, it talks about how Ezekiel. Let's get Ezekiel, the 33rd chapter. Because, see, Noah, he was blowing a trumpet. You know, he said, it's going to rain. It's going to rain. Yeah, right. Oh, old man, you go ahead. It's going to rain. They had never seen rain. They had every right not to believe, so to speak. But the whole thing was, did it happen? Yes, it did rain. Okay? So over here in Ezekiel, it says what? Read, please.
Again.
Again. So you see, each time this thing is going over and over and over again for us, that we, if I didn't get it the first time or the second time, you know, I'm thankful to Yahshua that he overturned it and overturned this thing and keep telling it to me. And people, you know, you look around and people talk about, oh, I can remember this. I can't remember half of what I did yesterday and late last night. But you know what? I'm depending on Yahshua to bring those things to my remembrance, to take care of me. Because truly, I'm going to tell you, you're going to by and by come to the conclusion that you cannot do anything of yourself. You have to truly know that he is the one that careth for you and going to take care of you. That's why he told them children of Israel, they didn't do any work to get, even to get here. They didn't do anything. He said, I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. I was the one who tore up all this stuff down here in the land of Egypt with Pharaoh. I did this in Egypt. He said, and your eyes have seen what I have done. It wasn't what you did and they did. And when he got them over there and he gathered together over there in Joshua 24th chapter, and they presented themselves unto Yahweh Elohim. He said, now, I did this. I sent Moses and Aaron. Now, these people murmured and grumbled against Moses and Aaron every step of the way. He said, but you know what? I did that. I did that. You didn't have anything to do with that. But what did you do? You murmured against my servant all every step of the way. And really, Yahweh Elohim used Moses for their good. But they couldn't see that, you know. And you have the same thing going on now. Why? Because you do want people to see, know, and understand something about their creator in truth and reality. At one time, yes, we was up under this right here. But in the fullness of time, Yahweh sent forth his son, come himself, Yahshua, to bring us up out of this darkness into his marvelous light. To know that his true name is Yahweh, his divine title is Elohim, and the name of Yahweh in this Savior mode, sonship mode, is Yahshua. These three are one. Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua. These three are one. Why you say that? Because we are made in his image and after his likeness. I have a head cavity, a chest cavity, and an abdominal cavity. It's not three of me. It's just one. And he put that thing on us so we would be, as Romans 1:19-20 said, we'll be without excuse. We are without excuse. Read, please. Ezekiel 33:1.
again. Uh-huh. The word of Yahweh came unto me, saying, uh-huh, Son of man.
Son of man. Read.
Speak to the children of thy people.
He said, speak to the children of thy people. Read, please.
And say unto them, uh-huh, when I bring the sword upon a land.
When you bring the sword upon the land. When no. I, he said, when I bring the sword upon the land. The sword, the word of truth. Read, please.
If, mm-hmm, the people of the land take a man of their coast, uh-huh, and set him for, mm-hmm, their watchman.
Read, please.
If, when he seeth the sword come.
Now, he see the sword come, read.
Upon the land.
Upon the land.
He blow the trumpet.
There's another sounding of the trumpet. Blow the trumpet. Said, blow the trumpets in Zion. Now, he said, son of man, he said, when you see, blow the trumpet. Look, people, look around. You got all this chaos that's going on in the world. And when I see those things, I think about how back there in Genesis with Noah, it said, and the wickedness of man is great upon the earth. And every thought and intent of his heart is only evil continually. So when you're watching those things, then what happened? Well, after that, when Yahweh saw that, he said, he said, the end of all flesh has come before me. Make thee an ark. Okay? Yahshua is the ark. So then, he himself is the ark of safety. Not this old physical ark. We're not talking about physical. We're talking about being in the ark of safety. The true Savior. The true salvation. The true ark. The only escape. The only way. Is in Yahshua. Read, please.
When I bring the sword upon a land, uh-huh, if the people of the land take a man of their coast and set him, mm-hmm, for their watchman, uh-huh, if when he seeth the sword come, mm-hmm, upon the land,
read, please.
He blow the trumpet.
He blow the trumpet. Read.
And warn the people.
And warn the people. Well, what is going on? The trumpet is blowing. You're having this gospel being preached. He's using the airwaves, how to say, the YHWH. Everywhere you go, you can put it up on the computers. You can put it up on the cell phone. I mean, everywhere you see him, Yahweh is giving you no escape to this thing. You cannot escape this. Why? Because you are without excuse. Read.
Then whosoever,
read.
Hear the sound of the trumpet.
Hear the sound of the trumpet. You got to hear the sound of the trumpet. Read.
And taketh not warning.
Now, if you hear it, and I ain't bothered about it. Okay. Read.
If the sword come, read, and take him away.
And take him away.
His blood. Shall be upon his own head.
It's on his own head. Why? Read.
He heard the sound of the trumpet.
He heard the sound of the trumpet.
And took not warning.
He did not take warning. What happened back here when Moses had told them what Yahweh was going to bring and rain down all that hail and stuff on? He said, all the ones back here, I mean down in the land of Egypt. He said, all the ones that was in Egypt who believed that what Moses said was going to happen, they took their cattle out of the field and they took them into shelter. But the ones who didn't believe it, what happened? They was left without and they died. Same thing now. You're going to hear the word of Yahweh or you're going to die. You know. Read.
He heard the sound of the trumpet, uh-huh, and took not warning.
Read.
His blood shall be upon him.
Read, please.
But he that taketh warning.
But he that taketh warning, read.
Shall deliver his soul.
Shall deliver his soul. So you have the blowing of the trumpet. The blowing of the trumpet. Okay, so now, well, what is the trumpet sounding? What is it talking about? It's talking about the good news of Yahshua. How that he have what? Come in. He has died for you. Been buried for you. Resurrected for you. Poured out his Holy Spirit in the hearts and minds of men. And now he has come. Yahshua is come. Not coming, he is come. Present tense. So that's the good news. And if you know what it is,
they have a thing I was reading the other day. They was talking about how the man was talking about fake news, fake news, fake news. Okay, well, this not fake news. The death, the burial, the resurrection, and ascension of one Yahshua the Messiah and the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. That's the good news. And that is the gospel. And the gospel is how the Messiah died. But guess what? It's got to be according to the scripture. Let's read that out of the book, because I want you to know that it is in the book. In 1 Corinthians 15 and 1, please read.
Moreover, brethren.
Read, please.
I declare unto you.
Now, I declare unto you the gospel. Read.
Which I preached
unto
you.
Which I preached unto you. Read.
Which also ye have received.
Which also you have received. Read.
And wherein ye stand.
And wherein ye stand. Read.
By which also ye are saved.
Now you are saved. Read.
If ye keep in memory what I preached unto you.
So that's Yahshua. He said, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, well, he the one who gonna keep it in memory. I told you I have a memory. It wasn't about anything. Read.
Unless ye have believed in vain.
In other words, you said that's the non-effect. Read, please.
For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received.
So I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I received. Well, what had I received? I received that Yahshua, he was the salvation down here. In Exodus, the 12th chapter, he was the one that told them to take every man a lamb. And then what he said, drain their blood. Put the blood on the upper lintel and the two side posts dipping from a basin. That was the 4 points of blood. Blood. Come on down, Yahshua, out here on this cross. 1, 2, 3, 4 points of blood. I'm looking for the 4 points of blood. I'm looking for the witness. You see, he said, my witness is true. You see, so you're looking for the blood. Then what did he say? Then they said, now look, he said, roast lamb, bitter herbs, unleavened bread. This was a roast lamb out here in the heat of the day. And then what they do? They had to take the bitter gall, raise it up there to his mouth. You see, you got death, 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 death. He out here on this cross. So then he said, with bitter herbs, okay, unleavened bread. They had to have unleavened bread. No yeast hadn't risen yet, you see. So they had to have that blood. They had to have that unleavened bread. So that's a death. And that's a burial. And then what he said, what? You be ready. He said, have your shoes on your feet. Have your loins girded. Have your staff in your hand. Why? He said, this is Yahweh's Passover. What? I'm passing over from death to life. Look, and you know what I look at? He bringing them with him. Way back here. I'm the one. Why? He was the one that went before them to lead them as an angel in this cloud, typifying spirit. And then it goes on to say, look, I'm going to send my angel before you. He said, don't provoke him. You know, so you have them coming up out of the land of Egypt by death. Death. They are buried in the Red Sea. Burial. And they resurrect up here out in this wilderness. Okay, death, burial, resurrection. And then what? They go on into sin, on into the land of Canaan. Then you come on down to Jonah. Well, what he got to do? He Yahweh telling to go to Nineveh. No, I'm going to Tarshish. I don't want to go. You're stubborn. Okay, then I'll have to deal with you. So he goes on into the ship. Go down in the belly of the ship. That's down in the belly of hell, you see. And then what you got? A great tempest come up. And they go down there and wake him up and say, now look, wake up, old sleeper. Mm-hmm. He down there hiding out. He said, now look. In other words, what nationality are you? What Elohim? Look, who do you serve? He said, look, I flee from the Elohim of the heavens and the dry land. Look, in other words, he couldn't escape. Mm-hmm. Because he was running. Look, where you going to go? What David said? Where can I go from the presence of Yahweh? If I make my bed in hell, it said, behold, he is there. He is there. He said, if I take the wings of an eagle and fly to the uttermost parts of the sea, the sky, wherever, Yahweh is there too. No matter if I go down
So old Jonah, he down there, buried down there. And then what he said, okay. He said, now they said, well, we don't want no innocent blood on our hand. Why they got to talk about innocent blood? Why? Because this was innocent blood. Why that be innocent blood? No fault found in this lamb. If no fault found in the lamb, kill him. No fault found. Power said, what? I find no fault with this man. They didn't have no other choice. They said, crucify. That's the one. Why? Because he's taking upon himself the sin of the world. Mm-hmm. So then what they got to do? They got to march him on out there to Golgotha and impale him. And that's what old Elijah was saying. If Yahweh be Elohim, he said, you serve him. Said, but if Baal be Elohim, you serve him. But old Elijah, see, people look at, it was a prescribed way that he had to fix that altar.
That's
he
right.
didn't just do it in an old kind of way.
Right.
Why? Because this lamb has got to be a prescribed way. So Elijah get out there and he repair the altar. And then what he do? He got to put that wood in place. Why? He got to be impaled to the cross. Mm-hmm. See, the cross can't be on top of him. Mm-hmm. He got to be impaled to the cross. So then what he say? He said, then pour the water around the first time. He said, do it the second time. Do it the third time. And if Yahweh be Elohim, then let him. In other words, come on down, do your thing. Mm-hmm. Show these people that you are the Elohim.
Sure.
You are the Elohim. Worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised is Yahweh Elohim. And that's what they had to submit and admit. Because after a while, when Elijah got through offering up the prayer, and he had everything in order. You see, it's got to be in order. Why? It's got to be to the law. It's got to be to the testimony. Got to come on down in you and for you to see it. So he says, what? Okay. And then they stand around. They stand around waiting. But see, Elijah, he said, now look, it's going on about the evening sacrifice. Mm-hmm. See, but why? Because Yahshua, he got to be the morning and the evening lamb. Mm-hmm. And Elijah, he wait for the evening sacrifice. And he going to offer it up at 3 o'clock. And they said, what? Then all of a sudden, the fire of Yahweh fell. Licked up the sacrifice. Burned it up, consumed the sacrifice. Licked up the water and the dust. Wasn't nothing left. Why? Because Yahweh, our Elohim, is a consuming fire. And the only thing you got to do is be obedient. He said, if you be obedient to me, he told Israel when he took them on up out here in the 19th chapter of Exodus, he said, if you will be obedient unto me, then what? You're going to be a peculiar people unto me. So when you see David, he just round there, just dancing before Yahweh Elohim, enjoying in him. And then you got somebody sitting on the sideline, hating on him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's just the way it is. But see, you give all the glory, all the praise to Yahweh. So Jonah, he had to say, look, take me up, cast me forth, and it'll be okay. Why? Because Yahweh gave him something to do, and he was trying to be disobedient. And once he took him up, cast him, they said, we don't want this innocent blood on up, but you got to do it. Why? The power said, I find no fault in him, but the people keep saying, crucify him. I got to do it. Okay, why? He said, because the scriptures cannot be broken. So what you have is, it's when Jonah, when they cast him forth, Yahweh had prepared a great fish to swallow him up. And all Jonah down there, and the reeds just wrapped around his head. Why the reeds got to be wrapped around his head? Because Yahshua had to have what? A crown of thorns around his head. And he said, out of the fish's belly, I cried. Well, what you crying for now? Why? Because Yahweh have worked the work with you, and you're going to be obedient, you see. So he said, out of the fish's belly, let's see. Jonah
2:1.
Read, please, because I do want you to know that what we're talking to you about is in that Bible that you've been carrying around with you and haven't opened it. All these things are there. And for you to come and learn about Yahweh and truth and reality and know how to use your principles that he has set up, that's your precept. So you can see a death. You can see a burial. You can see a resurrection. You can see an ascension. You see what I'm saying? You can see it for yourself. Read, please.
It's start of Jonah 1:14.
Read, please.
Wherefore?
Wherefore?
They cried unto Yahweh.
They cried unto Yahweh, saying,
we beseech thee, O Yahweh.
We beg you, O Yahweh. Read.
We beseech thee.
Read.
Let us not perish.
Let us not perish. Read.
For this man's life.
For this man's life. Look here. Says, look, he had to get this cross for the sin of the world. It said, if not, then we'll perish, you see. So if you got it back there, you got to come down and see Yahshua fulfilling that thing. Read, please.
And lay not upon us.
Read.
Innocent blood.
Don't lay innocent blood on us. Read.
For thou, O Yahweh, has done as it pleased thee.
You see, that's the crux of the matter. It said, Yahweh, you have done what it pleased thee. Read.
So they took up Jonah.
So they took him up. Listen, they had to impale him to the cross, and then they had to raise it up. And that's what he said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Read, please.
So they took up Jonah.
Read.
And cast him forth.
Cast him forth. Read.
Into the sea.
Into the sea.
And the sea ceased.
And the sea ceased from its raging. Why? When in Yahshua, he got this calm the sea. You know, everything he's doing, he's walking, he's talking according to the law and the prophets. Because why he said, the scriptures talking about me. So then when you see me back there, I'm old Jonah. When you see me back here, I'm Moses. When you see me back here, I'm old Elijah. I'm just walking down through the ages and dispensation and come all the way down. And they said, here I am. This is I. Read, please.
Then the men feared Yahweh exceedingly.
Exceedingly, read.
And offered a sacrifice
unto Yahweh. They offered a sacrifice unto Yahweh. Well, what was the sacrifice? Truly, they had cast him forth. Read.
Now Yahweh had prepared a great fish.
A great fish, read.
To swallow up Jonah.
To swallow up Jonah.
And Jonah was in the belly of the fish.
He was in the belly of the fish. Read.
3 days.
3 days.
And 3 nights.
3 nights. So then they could come talking to Yahshua. Well, show us a sign. He said, there will be no sign save the sign of Jonah. As Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. So like I said, they have the law and the testimony.
That's right.
Let them hear them. If they don't want to hear the law and the testimony, sorry, Charlie. Because that's how Yahweh got it set up. Now, after he's down there and he's off in there, read.
Jonah, second chapter.
Read.
Then Jonah prayed unto Yahweh.
Incense. All with offering up incense. The prayer. That's Yahshua making intercession for him. Read.
Prayed unto Yahweh.
Prayed unto Yahweh. Read.
His Elohim.
Read, please.
Out of the fish's belly.
Out of the fish's belly. Out of the belly of hell. Read.
And said,
read, please.
I cried by reason of mine affliction.
Read, please.
Unto Yahweh.
Read, please.
And he heard me.
And he heard me. He said, my El, why hast thou forsaken me? Read, please.
And thou heardest my, out of the belly of hell cried I.
Read, please.
And thou heardest
you
my voice.
You heard my what?
My voice.
My voice. Read, please.
For thou hadst cast me into the deep.
Yes, read.
In the midst of the sea.
In the midst of the sea.
And the floods compassed me about.
He can talk about it. Read, please.
All thy billows and thy waves passed over me.
Read, please.
Then I said.
Then said I. Read,
I
please.
Am cast out of thy sight.
I'm cast out of thy sight. You know, it's like that night of fear I'm sitting in. It was Yahweh, I'm cast out of your sight. I don't have no other hope, none other Savior but Yahshua. Read, please.
Yet.
Yes.
I will look again.
I will look again. Read.
Toward thy holy temple.
Toward thy holy temple. Read.
And the water compass me about.
And the water compass me about. Read, please.
Even to the soul.
Read, please.
The depth closed me round about.
Read.
The weeds were wrapped about my head.
You see, it's in there. It's like they used to have this commercial. What it was, it Prego.
Prego.
It's in there. If you go back, if you be obedient to that spoken word, and Yahshua said, go back to the law and the testimony, then you're gonna find all the answers, and you'll be able to see it for yourself. It's not. Don't take my word for anything that have been said up here. I'm delivering unto you
First of all, that which I received. And that's what he have given unto me. And you'll find out that what? After he, when that fish spewed him out on dry land, and then Jonah went on and said, what? Yet 40 days. Mm-hmm. Why it's got to be 40 days? Death, burial, resurrection. Then he what? Ascend to the Father. He was seen by them what? 40 days. So then what you got to do? He tarried for 40 days. So what you got? You got him. He got to fulfill those things that we're reading back there. Why? Because his blood, his water, his spirit. How long was these children out here? Mm-hmm. 40 years. Mm-hmm. Then what he do? He goes to John to be baptized. Death is on him. He's buried. Mm-hmm. Death, mm-hmm. burial. What he do? He goes straightway up into the wilderness. How long was he there? 40 days, a day for a year. They were 40 years. Mm-hmm. He was 40 days, mm-hmm. a day for a year. You mm-hmm. see these principles of 40 coming all the way down. That's why the Apostle Saul can say, I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received. So how did the Messiah die for our sins and was buried and rose again the third day? He did it according to the scripture. You see what I'm saying? It's got to be according to the scripture. It can't be just your way. But you have this witness in you. Whatever food you eat is dead, right? It's buried in you. And it's going to resurrect some to glorification and some to damnation. It's proof in your own physical body. And your body don't have any problem getting rid of that which does not make the body healthy. And it has a casting off. So it absorbs your carbohydrates, your fats, and your proteins. And it uses that to give you energy and everything. And then the other part, it casts off. Some into, you know, it's at a sea of forgetfulness. Well, I tell you what, you go to the toilet. And when you flush, do you be, no. You want it gone into the sea of forgetfulness. Well, what? He said, now this is what he done to those angels who lost their first mm-hmm. estate. They are on reserve in chains of everlasting darkness. So be thankful to Yahweh. I'm thankful that he has given me something to proclaim, to shout about. And when Yahshua over there in John the 17th chapter, and he talks about, he says, Father, the hour is come. He said, glorify thy son, that thy son also may glorify thee. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know that thou only, that Yahweh is the only true Elohim and Yahshua the Messiah, whom the Father has sent. That's the whole, that's just the total reality of the thing. That Yahweh is the only true Elohim and Yahshua the Messiah, whom the Father has sent. These three are one. Now he said, let this spirit be in you that was also mm-hmm. in Yahshua the Messiah. They say Yahweh have highly exalted Yahshua and given him a name that is above every name. And that's why I said, if there is salvation in only one name. Well, you can call him whatever you want. And no, you can't. You can't call me whatever you want to and get away with it. And I know about it from a natural standpoint. Mm-hmm. You know, so, I mean, come on now. But this thing, this teaching, this truth that we are showing you is how everything about you declares and witness to your Heavenly Father. Everything. So when the time or you're hearing the blowing of the trumpet, you know, I prefer it be together than together. But it ain't my preference. Not the sound of the alarm, you know. And that's just what's going on. But this is what Yahshua have given unto us. Because if we had the blowing of the trumpet back there with Moses. We had the blowing of the trumpet with Ezekiel. Now, Revelations 10 and 7. When we talk about the founder of this organization having a stupendous divine vision revelation. Now, this is the conclusion of the matter. You got the trumpet sounding. Trumpet sounding, trumpet sounding. Read, please.
Revelation 10:7.
Read, please.
But in the days.
In the days.
Of the voice.
Of the voice.
Of the seventh angel.
Of the seventh angel. There are seven ages and seven dispensations. And what you are looking at is each time in this age and dispensation, whenever Yahweh was bringing something up on the land, he raised up a man. Mm-hmm. He raised up a man. He raised up a man and showed that man something that the world did not see, did not have. I don't care what was going on at that time, okay? When the flood came, he raised up Noah, mm-hmm. showed him a divine mm-hmm. vision. In the 480th year of Noah's life, he had a divine vision, and he preached for 120 years. You see what I'm saying? And what he and Yahweh gave him divine specifications, mm-hmm. okay? Of how or in what manner to build an ark mm-hmm. for the saving of those eight souls back there. And you have that witness in you. I mean, you just can't beat it. You got eight right there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you just can't beat it. Okay, so he raised up a man there. When the children of Israel was ready to come up, when Yahweh got ready to bring them up out of there, according to his promise that he made with Abram over there in Genesis the 15th chapter, he raised him up a man. Mm-hmm. Moses learned in all the ways and customs of the Egyptians and everything. He was well prepared for Yahweh's service. You hear me? And that's what I look at. I mean, he took that man and made him where he would be able. And then he gave him Aaron to speak. I don't speak well. I got that covered. Mm-hmm. You know, I got that covered. Don't worry about it. And then in the fullness of time, they came on back down here to this people. He said, this is what you tell them. He said, Israel is my son. He said, let my son go that he may serve me. And I tell you, he said, a whole congregation of the children of Israel were brought forth up out of the land of Egypt to and through the divided waters of the Red Sea out here in the wilderness of Sinai. And Yahweh called them around this mountain. And he gave them the words, his word, and he introduced himself. He said, I'm Yahweh, thou Elohim, who brought you mm-hmm. out of the land of Egypt. I did that. Out of the house of bondage. I did that. I did that. I did. I'm Yahweh. And you want to say, it don't matter. Oh, yeah. It matters. I am Yahweh, thy Elohim, the 20th chapter of Exodus, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Let me tell you something. Thou shalt have no Elohim beside me. Mm-hmm. And he's not going to have it down here neither. These are the things that we need to know. We need to get these things learned in our heart and in our mind so we can have that stability where we are with the things that are going on now. So when the voice of the seventh angel, when he began to sound, what's going to happen? It said the mystery of Yahweh should be finished. And that's what's going on where we are down here. So we have brought you from the law and the prophets and the fulfillment down to the reality, the sounding of the trumpet. And he said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness. For a witness, that's Matthew 24:14. He said, and then shall the end come. I do hope that something have been said that will stir up your pure heart and mind to make you have or want that innate desire to truly learn about Yahweh and his son Yahshua, the way he really is and the way he actually exists. I do thank you for your time.
Hallelujah.
Our next speaker for this session will be Dr. Olivia Dobbins.
I'd like to say good morning.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. I thoroughly enjoyed the previous vessel, and I wanted to put a flag out there. Go on, go on. But it is an honor and a privilege to be able to testify to some of the things, just some of the things, that Yahweh has revealed unto me since being in attendance in this school.
And as the vessel had said, that there's a prescribed way that we go about this. I remember my early days in the school, and especially after moving down here to the Memphis area, because they call this the Bible Belt. And not only the Bible Belt, but I noticed that there were so many Bible schools, schools that teach people that are wanting to go into the ministry, or even lay people that want to attend, and they call them Bible colleges, and sometimes we use the word seminaries. But when you go there, eventually you can graduate, and as I mentioned on previous programs, how that in the old days you just had a minister that had a calling, but many of the ministers are going and getting their bachelor's, master's, even PhDs, so that, you know, for years they called us doctors. Well, they really have the DD, Doctor of Divinity, behind their name. But when we look at this teaching, that's one of them things, this and that, when we look at this teaching as compared to what they're teaching at the seminary, there is just no comparison to it. I want you to go get me John, let's see, but the Comforter.
John 14:26.
And I'm going to paraphrase something. Romans 1:19-20. That's how Yahweh showed me, by showing me by things that I have seen, then translating it to the spiritual or the reality of it. Take the natural things or the visible things of Yahweh, they show forth the spiritual. That's Romans 1:19-20. So we're going to start over here with John.
John 14:26. Mm-hmm. But the Comforter.
But the Comforter, the vessel. We were watching some of the brethren in other classes. We watched them sort of like for our Sunday school. And we were talking about how that when we say that give Yahweh the glory, he puts you in a situation where he shows up and he shows you that of your own self, you could do nothing to get yourself out of that situation. So therefore, he makes you, as it says in Isaiah, whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Not only just make you understand doctrine, make you understand that you're not about nothing. You can't deliver yourself out of these physical situations. That's just to show you. You cannot deliver yourself spiritually, so it takes a savior. And as the vessel was saying on the TV show, well, when did he come to save? Did he just find out that he was going to be the savior here? No. He was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. But you can't understand what you cannot see. So the lamb came down, was identified by John. That's John's whole mission, was to point him out that this is the only salvation is through. We point here because that's what we're familiar with. Yahshua the Messiah. That is salvation. So we're going to go back to John there. And we know that we need comfort. In this day and time, we need comfort. Folk, we don't need a telegraph to tell us. If we thought the world was on a razor's edge during the Cold War, then think about the world on a razor's edge now. See, back in the Cold War, you just really had the big giants. You had, you know, you had the communist bloc and the countries that they dealt with. And then you had, I guess you call them the NATO countries, those that fought the Allied side. You know, Russia did, but, you know, split from us. But now, you got all these little stands, Paducahstan, Kyrgyzstan, this stand, Pakistan. Every last one of them stands has their nuclear capabilities, or they're trying to get nuclear capabilities. When I'm pointing here, though, but when it was all up under the map, all them little stands, Poland and all the rest of them, Yugoslavia, it was all under the Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. The Soviet Union had control over all of those nuclear silos, nuclear weapons. When they said, okay, look, the Cold War fell, boom, the Berlin Wall fell, boom, all of this fell, all them little stands kept whatever was in their country. Now you got all these little countries, little tyrants, got their finger on the button. And every time you're looking around, somebody trying to steal some plutonium. What they stealing it for? They ain't trying to make energy. They're trying to get what? A nuclear weapon to put their finger on the button. So you look at the world, and we don't even need to get into the political situation. If we thought it was bad in the Cold War, think about what the world thinks about us. They either holding their breath or calling us crazy. It's one of the two things. So we need comfort from a physical standpoint, which should point us to that we need comfort from a spiritual standpoint. Read.
But the Comforter, mm-hmm. who is the Holy Spirit.
Who is the Holy Spirit. Now, that's going to be our comfort, the Holy Spirit. We know that that is Yahshua the Messiah. In, this is why we point here, in or what? Out of a physical body. It still goes by the name of Yahshua, and that is the Holy Spirit or the Comforter. Read.
But the Comforter, who is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name.
People say it don't matter about a name. Yes, it does, because that Comforter, when he comes, he's coming in what? The Father's going to send him in a name, in his name. Well, who was talking? See, we play crazy. Yahshua was talking. Read.
Shall teach you all things.
Shall teach you all things. Now, we talk about, I'm backing around here to the founder. We talk about the founder of the school. Said he went to the sixth grade in common elementary school. Well, back in those days, you might have mixed grades in a common elementary school. And when we was in elementary school, we didn't pass up and down the hallway like we did in junior high school. Basically, you went into Mrs. Jones's room, and peradventure, you didn't like Miss Jones. Because it wasn't like in high school or junior high school, you count the clock down 45 minutes and I'm out of here. You're going to be with that teacher all day. And they're going to teach you what? All things. Everything that comes in under that curriculum guideline, that one teacher is going to teach it to you. Okay? Then you go over and you say, well, that's just elementary school. What are they talking about in Tennessee? Common Core. Common Core. And then they want the teachers to go and continue in education for the teachers. They want them to continue to have these courses and come back with these different certificates saying, well, I have kept my teaching certificate up to date. Mm-hmm. Why? It's just a showing, a type in the shadow of Yahshua the Messiah. The Comforter, when he comes, he's going to what? You talking about a master teacher? Mm-hmm. He's going to teach all things. Well, the question should be, how can this Comforter, which has a name, teach all things? Well, one thing about it is he knows all things. How does he know all things? Because when we go over to, give me John 1 and 1, but keep your finger there, but give me John 1 and 1.
John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the Word.
We didn't before, I crawled in all over, but the point is, we didn't know this before coming in here. If somebody had stood us all up in a row, I don't care where we came from, and just thanks to the Father, we got YouTube, because there's plenty of witnesses. We have people that were natural born Hebrews, people that are Methodists, Jehovah Witness, Episcopalian, Catholic, just line us all up, a Baptist, whatever, Church of God in Christ, just made up my own religion. You line us all up and you ask us what the Word was, we'd all gave the same answer, the book. We'd have held up a Bible and said, this is the Word. Come down here to this teaching as a vessel labored to say there's a prescribed way. And this prescribed way, a prescription, eradicates that ignorance that we had when we came in here. So in the beginning was the Word. It wasn't a printed Bible in the beginning. People, we know the history of it. Come on. Read. In the beginning was the Word.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
Wait, now, this was in the beginning. This Word was in the beginning with Yahweh. And we say that Yahweh is eternal. So this Word is with him. Read. Now, it looks like we got two.
And the Word was Yahweh.
Okay, now the two turn into the one. Because it says the Word, what?
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh.
With him.
And the Word was
Yahweh. And it was Yahweh, so they one and the same.
Hallelujah.
Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. Mm-hmm. All things were made by him.
Some things.
All things were made by him.
Knock it out the park. Where'd the devil come from? We got the devil as a self-existent deity running wild. No. All things were made by him. But we didn't know that till we came down here. Since being in attendance in this school and going through the prescribed way, we cut it up now because, you know, we figure out we done been in class 30, 40 years. Everybody know it. All of this, the prescription, the prescribed way, answers and eradicates the ignorance that we had. Did not Yahweh raise up? Now, he told Moses, for very deed have who raised Pharaoh up? I raised him up so that what? I might
show forth my power.
Show forth my, so what did he do? Made himself a worthy adversary. So then if Yahweh raised up Pharaoh and made him a worthy adversary, over in Isaiah, he point blank tells you, I formed the light. My essence is light. Now, if I'm going to have the opposite of light, it don't exist at this state. I must what? Create darkness or create evil. That's right. What it says. All things was made by him. That's how come he could tell you or teach you all things, because he made all things. I'm taking this class in a video production, and the teacher said, look now, I know a bunch of y'all are going to wait till it's too late, and then you're going to run up, set the camera up, and do a how-to. You're going to show me how to do something that you know how to do. I just laugh at it because every night he tell us that 3 or 4 times now. But he said, don't tell me nothing about how to make a peanut butter sandwich or something simple. Yeshua the Messiah is the one that can tell you how. The vessel was talking about in what manner, for what reason, for what purpose, how. That's what he's doing. He can do it because he created it all. And he's sitting down demonstrating it all for us. All things was made by him. And John?
All things were made by him. And without him was not anything made that was made.
So we could go into semantics of Old English or colloquial English. Or what did it mean? Look, if it exists, it was made. That's a given. If it exists, it was made. And it says, without him was not anything
made.
So if it exists, he made it. Just cut and dry. Why he act the way he does? Because Yahweh is showing forth his power. Folk, we see it on TV all day long. They talk about if you just get up and walk, that, you know, especially, you know, if you know, whatever, walking is a natural way to keep healthy, keep fit, cardiovascular, for your weight. It'll help you with all the things that keep your joints going. But look, when you watch that thing on TV, they say, now look, you can do this with 15 minutes a day, and after so many months, I lost 30, 40 pounds, you know, that dropped down 2 dress sizes. But wait a minute now, it ain't just walking like this. Oh, no. They say that's a stair climber, a stepper, an ellipse. Well, what is it doing? It's putting resistance. You are stepping against resistance. And that is what is building up the body and bringing it into a healthy state, a vigoration. So what did Yahweh do? To show forth his glory, he created resistance. He created an adversary that is the direct opposite. Simply that he says, yes, the devil's job is to say no. Yahshua the Messiah, Peter, well, what's going to happen? Oh, nay, ain't nothing going to happen to you. Yahshua say, get thee behind me, what? Satan. Right. Yahshua says, I must go. This is going to happen.
I'm going to be killed. Mm-hmm. Devil and Peter say what? No. Nay, nay. Just simple as that. Cat, mm-hmm. dog. That's the devil's job. And you know, it's a struggle for Yahweh to control him. No, he's just the direct opposite. He's a liar and a murderer from the very beginning. Yahshua said when he tell a lie, he telleth of his own. That's his children, mm-hmm. the children of lies. Read on in John.
In him was life.
In him was life. Talking about this word was life.
And the life was the light of men.
And the life was the light of men. So if in him was life and light, salvation, mm-hmm. when he creates an adversary, if he's life, then it's just simply put, the adversary mm-hmm. is what? Death. If Yahshua is light, or the word is light, mm-hmm. then the adversary is what?
Darkness. Mm-hmm.
Just the direct, it's just yin and yang. It's just that simple. Ain't no sweat. Read.
There was a man sent from Yahweh whose name was John.
It's talking about John the Baptist. And that was so funny. The vessel was talking about John's purpose. Born full of the Holy Spirit, waste his whole lifetime to have a purpose. What was his purpose? To be down there at the River Jordan. Mm-hmm. It was like Mission Impossible. Just down at the, should you take this assignment, Mr. Phelps? You're going to go down to the River Jordan, the one that you see the Spirit descend on like a dove. That is the Messiah. That's your purpose. And, you know, John down there baptizing, just baptizing. Ain't nothing happening. Baptizing. Ain't nothing happening. Baptizing. Then it says, you see, you have to read both translations. One saying, after all the people were baptized, then cometh Yahshua to John to be baptized. See, the world talks about he instituted. How you gonna set it up? And the scriptures say after all the people came. This ain't like Tennessee State, the drum major died at the end. You know, in the old days, the drum major was out front. You got these new bands. I'm still young enough that playing in some of them. The drum major at the end, the band already on the field. Then here come the drum major running all up through the band doing a split. No, supposed to be leading. If Yahshua instituted, mm-hmm. he would have to be the first one in. He should have been down there. Him and John get things ready, lighting the tiles up and stuff, if he instituted. But he was the what? Phylum terminale, end of a line for salvation. He said, thus it becomes us to fulfill all righteousness. And John did what? Suffered him. And then that's when the heavens opened and Yahweh spoke and said, this is my beloved son. And then Yahshua was caught straightway up by the Spirit into the wilderness. As the vessels say, when they led of the cloud of the Spirit straightway on into the wilderness, you got Yahshua led straightway on up after John's baptism. That was all. And look, after that point, John started going downhill. You know, I'm the one that cometh before me. The one that cometh after me is
before me.
Please get that, because I'm stumbling all with it. Luke. It's right above where they come with Yahshua and the Galilee, when John is talking to them. Who told you to come down here? Come down here and be baptized. Who told you, generation, to flee? Where do we go to pick up John's baptism? It's in that same chapter.
Matthew.
Oh, is that you got it in Matthew?
I was going over to Matthew's 3:13.
Okay. Go up some.
Okay. Matthew 3, and I'll start at 1. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
He's going down there. Mm-hmm. And look, this thing is, the vessel said this thing is so tight. But I want to say this because I keep on, can't get to it. The point is that there is a way. Mm-hmm. And Isaiah said there's a way that seemeth right to a man. We can go to all these different seminaries and study at the feet of Gamaliel. But just like Saul, we're going to have to admit that all of that we mm-hmm. thought the ways lead somewhere, Isaiah said that these are the ways of death. Mm-hmm. So if they were the ways of death, the way that seemed right to a man is the way of death, we want the way of life. And that's what happened in our founder. June 6, 1931, Yahweh visited him and gave him, what we say it like that, vision and a revelation. We say a stupendous panoramic vision and a revelation. In essence, you can say it superseded that Isaiah had when he said, and the word came unto me, and Ezekiel said, and Isaiah and all the rest of them. Because when you read that panoramic vision, he was caught up under Yahweh when Moses went into the cloud in 1490 or 1491, and when John went into the cloud, caught up on the Sabbath day in AD 96, Dr. Killing was already in that day of eternity and was the only one. You can't go to no seminary and have them put together how that Moses on Mount Sinai and John the Revelator, seeing just the one showing of the movie, how that these things tie together. John seen him coming on down through the ages and the dispensations, one standing in the midst of the seven branch golden lampstand, only because Yahweh chose a man at the close of the age to come so that salvation might be brought, showing us that salvation is only in Yahshua the Messiah.
Read. Now you have Matthew 3 and 11. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance.
Look, that's what the world is doing. And what is the water? It's unto repentance. Read.
But he that cometh after me is mightier than I.
Okay, now his whole job is down there because it's one. I'm out here now. And we call John the Baptist what? The forerunner. Mm-hmm. Or out in front of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
But he that cometh after me is mightier than I.
Wait a minute, now you think I'm something down here, the crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way. He's mightier than me, read.
Whose shoes I am not worthy to bear.
That's a whole lecture in itself about why did he say something about shoes, because it goes back to Ruth and Naomi and the shoes of the Redeemer. That's why John is telling you, I can't wear them shoes. You walk a mile in my shoes. No, I can't wear those shoes. I'm not the Redeemer. I'm just the one that's heralding. I'm just the one sounding the trumpet that he is coming. Read.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire.
Wait a minute now. I'm down here. Mm-hmm. Baptizing you in water under repentance.
Yep.
Read that again where you were.
I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance.
Why, any fool can see that I'm down here baptizing with water, and the water baptism is unto what? Repentance. Mm-hmm. Why? Because they had to come to John and what? Repent. Duck their head and repent. Say that I have sinned. Then John would permit them. See, that's the whole thing in the conversation. See, it never made no sense. Why the Savior came to him and John, what, forbade him. Why? Because every last one of them lied. I'm a backbiter. I stole. It was 613. Now, they going to hit one of them. And they broke them and they repented and they were baptized. Then here come Yahshua to John. Why? No guile. This is Yahweh in a body. This is righteousness in a body. He has nothing to confess. That's what John said. Let's turn this thing around. I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? Yahshua say, suffer it to be so now. Because it fulfills. Read.
But he that cometh after me is mightier than I.
Mightier than I.
The
mighty one. Read.
Whose shoes I am not worthy to bear.
Uh-huh.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit.
I'm in water unto repentance.
Uh-huh.
But when he comes, whose shoes I can't even carry, he is going to baptize you in the same spot in some water.
No.
No. He's going to baptize you how?
With the Holy Spirit and fire.
And where did you can't read no translation if he's going to say that Yahshua added water to that equation. It's the Holy Spirit and fire. You read over either Luke or Saul says John indeed baptized with water. But there's going to be another baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire. They are not the same. One is an institution. One is the fulfillment. And really, the reality of the situation is the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Because what appeared on their heads on the day of Pentecost? Flames of fire like cloven tongues. That's your baptism with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Read.
Whose fan is in his hand.
Okay, and that's a whole thing. Okay.
13 verses.
No, I'll finish there. I want to go back to the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit.
But the Comforter.
So that was all John's mission, was to point out the Messiah. And from that point on, he said, I must decrease. Mm-hmm. And that's what he did. He decreased all the way down. You got to think about it. He pointed out Yahshua, behold the Lamb. Mm-hmm. He decreased all the way down to when he was thrown in prison. Mm-hmm. He sent some people to ask Yahshua, are you the one? Mm-hmm. Now that seemed like that's a decrease in faith and understanding. Mm-hmm. But he's got to decrease and be at a low point. Why? Because Yahshua is increasing. Mm-hmm. Read.
But the Comforter, mm-hmm. who is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, shall teach you all things.
Teach you all things. And again, YouTube. When we watch YouTube, it used to be, you know, when we would go to the conventions and we would hear the various vessels. I mean, vessels that were, of course, we knew our international vice president and dean is a licensed medical doctor. But, you know, over the years, we had some other doctors that have come up in this school. And nurses, nurse practitioners. And they put it on the pattern how that is all talking about Yahweh. We got people that are engineers and scientists, all manner of walks of life. Even down to the people, you know, some of us from an academic standpoint, I was talking about the effect of cocaine and those addictive drugs. And then the brothers took me outside and said, yeah, you did it from a clinical standpoint, but let me tell you how addiction feel from a real standpoint. So yeah, we got it all covered. Mm-hmm. So that he is just teaching us and expounding unto us his greatness. Read.
But the Comforter, who is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, shall teach you all things, mm-hmm. and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you.
And look, he takes us through things and brings it back to our remembrance, and we can't wait to just run down. The scripture says, I just can't tell it all. Just can't tell it. Just can't tell it. And different vessels you would hear, you would say, maybe they should have kept that one to themselves. But you know, it might be 1,000 people at the convention, but in the days we used to mill around and talk with people, don't you know we would hear about that one? 1 in 1,000 that was addressed to. That's the kind of L we serve. You know, that isn't, we're talking about that. He got 100 cattle on it, and he leave the 99 for the one. Folks, we have lived and witnessed that Yahshua the Messiah get that one that is out there, that is hurting, that is at distress, and a vessel just turn around and start talking. You say, where did they go? They done made a left turn, and they address something and come right on back to their point. They done put some salve on that one and put that one in a mood to be receptive. That's the kind of air we serve. This is awesome teaching that Yahweh has brought. And it's not that any of us can claim any portion of it for ourselves. It's the Holy Spirit that bring it back to your remembrance. And look, it's the Holy Spirit that can withhold it. I have had it happen to me. You can't buy a vow with Vanna White to even talk about the name of Yahweh if you think that you're going to be exalted and claim this teaching for yourself. It is an unmerited gift that Yahweh just use vessels as it suit him to tell
his own story. Read. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Mm-hmm. Not as the world giveth,
giveth. Read.
Let not your heart be troubled.
Oh my goodness, don't let our heart be troubled. And it's one place it's talking about a little flock. And that's what we are. Wherever, whatever our little, I just keep thinking about, oh, we could be like Elijah. Oh, Yahweh, I alone and I'm down in sackcloth and ashes. And he said, what? I got some. And I got them hid. I got them preserved. They're preserved. Not like the devil on reservation for the lake. These are preserved. They are put up. They are held captive in store. That they have not bowed a knee to Baal. No Nebo. So if we are still able to preach the unadulterated gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, we are among those brethren that Yahweh has kept. I want to go on over back to, I hate to go back, but there ain't nothing to talk about. The vessel was saying that. The good news, that's the good news. Go back and give me 1 Corinthians 15.
1 Corinthians 15 and 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain.
Unless you have believed in vain. Read.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. How?
That for what reason? I was looking it up and holding it. For what reason? For what purpose? All them little adjectives that in this adverb go along with how that to say for what reason did he do this? And when you go all the way back, you know, I keep using the analogy, just knock it out the park. All of the ignorance and the darkness in the world, Yahweh, in these little bitty classes, I don't care how big it is, even if the classes, some of them got to be thousands, it still was small congregations compared to the churches in their area. But Yahweh chose a remnant out the world, and then we find out a remnant of a remnant. Now, look how small is that going to be. He said, Dr. Kennedy came up in there to one of the conventions and said, it's too many people. Woo, my goodness. And you figure that from the size of that convention, even in comparison to the world, it's too many people. Read.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received.
Read.
How that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures. And that he was buried. And that he rose again. The third day, according to the scriptures.
All of what Yahshua the Messiah and vessels, I think we was going through with some other vessels, were talking about. If all of the things that Yahshua the Messiah said and did were written, it said the world could not contain the books. Because in the 3.5 years of his ministry, just the 3.5 of his ministry, letting on his whole life from conception. Oh my goodness, conception, and it's in our archetype, isn't it? Conception, birth, and flight.
Right.
That's according to a pattern that it had all of his life story had been written. If all of the things that he said and did, the world could not contain the books. But you know what? We don't have to go and try to find the lost books of Yahshua or the lost books of Jesus. It is enough in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to keep us scratching our head for a long time. It's a vessel now going through, showing to the Lord, to the, you know, the prophets, you know, just jot and tittle that you'll be able to line them up and see, oh, this is why he said that. This is why he said that. This is why he did that. And I was talking about that darkness that's on the world. They got upset years ago when they had that last temptation of Christ saying that the Savior didn't know why he came into the world until he was on the cross. That is really a little too late to understand. But here again, how come they cannot read? The vessel went through last time. Get me over there, Romans 10. Everybody call upon the name of Yahweh shall be saved.
Romans 10 and 9. That if thou shalt that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth that Yahshua is the Messiah, and shalt believe in thine heart.
But confession and believing. Read.
And believe in thine heart that Yahweh hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved.
Well, I old Dean got to wait for you to say that's a guarantee. That's the power of the name of the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, which is Yahshua, has the power to what? Save. Over in John, where we cut off, it says, to as many as Yah has given him, but also it says he's given them the power to become the sons. That is to them that what? Believe in a name. You can look, it takes power to believe in a name when the whole world is marching that way. And now we figure that here we are, the Institute. We're the true one that has kept going. And then what you have is all of these branch offs. And then we get upset because it's branch offs in the Institute. It's got to be. It's got to be. But there's still one that comes right on up through here. You look at this chart, and you always want to talk about somebody else. Carnal ordinances restored. I'm going to throw some shoes now. Who stopped them? When the Catholic Church started, they started with carnal ordinances. When did they ever stop them? Denied them. When the Baptists, we can go with Martin Luther, nailed his theses to the wall of the door of Wittenberg. He didn't nail every tenet of the Catholic Church. He just nailed some that he had a problem with. So, some he kept. And they contain works. A work is a what? A carnal ordinance. So Lutherans never stopped. When we watch all them movies about Henry VIII made the Anglican Church. Henry was a devout Catholic. He brought over some of them what? Carnal ordinances to the Catholic, to the Anglican Church. So you can just go through. None of them stopped doing a carnal ordinance. Well, who did stop? That's the question. Right. Who did stop? I tell you who stopped. When he had Peter up there on that house rooftop in Java, Peter had carnal ordinances on mine, because he was talking about, no, nay. When that sheep was let down and he saw all them crispy critters on that sheep, nay, master, nothing unholy has entered into unclean, has entered into my mouth. Yahweh said, look, what I've called clean, don't you call unclean. You read it for yourself. He's getting him ready. Psychologically, to go down there to the household of a Gentile. Peter still had that carnal line in him. But it was the followers of the way, the followers of Yahshua, the Messiah was the one. Saul says the Messiah is what? The end of the law. So we were the ones. The followers of Yahshua, the Messiah, were the ones who said carnal ordinances. He has come in the midst of the week, and he's called the sacrifices and the oblations to what? Cease. Cut off. Hallelujah. We are the ones that stop carnal ordinances. Physical ways of worshiping. I don't need to throw no shoes, because I know if I saw way over here in Memphis, y'all saw too that we having honeymoons and banquets and suppers and appreciations. I said, if we had done gone to church, that's the stuff we came out of. And Yahweh said in Revelation, come out of Babylon. And what do? We came out for a minute and we went right on back. We was just like the people over here. We're talking about leeks and melons. As Darby used to say, what about the whip and the taskmaster that went with it? Appreciations. Ain't that the stuff you had, pastor's appreciation? Well, then who restored carnal foolishness of ceremonies? It was us. So people talking about, well, it just looked like it ain't but a few of us and we done made a left turn. No, we are not the ones that made the left turn. We are the ones that have kept on. And somebody went, and the scriptures say that they had to go out from us so that people would know that they was never not caught. Of us. Not of us. Okay, where you read? Well, anyway, we're talking about the gospel of Yahshua.
Romans 10:10. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, mm-hmm. and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
Confession is made with your mouth. Read.
For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed.
Uh-huh. If you believe it on him, you shall not be ashamed. And you know, in all these little classes that's left over, these little remnants of a remnant, we pretty bold. We are not ashamed. Read. I've experienced it. When I left out from being a dean, and just went out, most of the people didn't know where I stood or anything. But those that knew me, that really, really knew me, they know I hadn't changed and I was ostracized. They know you. Read.
For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, uh-huh. for the same Elohim over all is rich unto all that call upon him.
That call upon him ain't going to change from calling upon the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of Yahweh shall be delivered.
You shall be delivered. That's a promise. Shall be delivered. And we talk about what did Moses, and it said that if Moses 80 years old, and he sent his 83-year-old brother out there so the two of them could come back down here. Well, why isn't it he just didn't say, oh, and that's the whole thing about go and come. Ain't what it look, it took a vision. We talk about want to just jump and shout about what Yahweh has. It ain't just knowledge that we hold over people's heads. It's mysteries. As it says in Revelations, the mysteries of Yahweh shall be finished when the seventh angel begins to sound. But it don't mean nothing till he sounds within you and you begin to see how all of these things tie up. Read.
How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed?
Okay, I was talking about that. How come it didn't say, Moses, go down, like the song, go down, Moses, way down in the Egypt land? How come it didn't say, go down in the Egypt land and go to 1401 apartment B in Goshen? Your brother and your fellow family members are there. And the 80-year-old man go down there and knock on the door and they have a family reunion. Do it make sense from a carnal standpoint that Yahweh, one, was down here in the land of Egypt and he told Aaron, what? Go out into the wilderness and meet your brother. Why? The vessel talked about it takes the law and the testimony. Yahweh said, look, I did this. I raised up Pharaoh. I made him a worthy adversary. All the world trembles at him. Just like in Isaiah. Oh, man, everybody, you know. Yahweh lifted him up until what? Till he found out. Till iniquity was found. And feet of clay was found in you. Look. It took an 80-year-old man and an 83-year-old man. He said, look, I made Pharaoh a worthy adversary, and I made you as what? My heir. That's the lawgiver. And then he said, I don't speak well. What did he tell me? Why did this heal his mouth? Had Aaron, the prophet, see in the mouth of what? Two or more witnesses. Took the law and the prophets to come down to do what? Set the captives free. Mm-hmm. So here we are. There's a prescribed way. We figure, I'm going to start here, I'm going to start there. No, then you might as well go on over there to the seminary. There's a prescribed way that they had to come out. I don't like roast lamb and stuff, but all you need to do is just, hey, it ain't personal. This takes our picture. It came over until the time of the of them over in Canaan's land, with Hophni and Phinehas. And we ain't talking about just some people off the street. Hophni and Phinehas were the two low priests.
Yeah.
And Yahweh had told them it's a prescribed way that the sacrifices were supposed to be done.
Right, right.
Even the people knew it was a prescribed way.
Right.
And Hophni and Phinehas said, no, we want ours parboiled. You know, and if the people said, no, don't do that. It said that their henchmen came with the flesh hooks and took the meat.
By force.
Mm-hmm. And Yahweh did what? Killed them. Mm-hmm. Killed them. There's a prescribed way. You didn't come and officiate in this tabernacle by throwing the tent up here and coming in through the side. And we figured that we're going to go into this pattern just any old kind of way. Nope. Read.
How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed?
How you gonna call on him in whom you have not believed? Read.
And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
Oh goodness, you have to hear. See, here come all the a simple thing. You're gonna be saved if you believe and you confess. Now here come the conditions. A, B, C, and D. Read.
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
Oh, then that's the people used to get us. Oh, I see, it didn't say a dean. Oh, it didn't say ministers. It said, how is it a preacher? A preacher. Y'all don't call yourselves preachers. Well, now that's just A, B, C. Now let's get on to E, D, E, and F, and G. Read.
And how shall they preach except they be sent?
Oh, now how they going to preach except they be sent?
As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things.
Of good things. Of good things. Now, being new in class, I'm looking at it from a carnal standpoint. Has some pretty good looking feet. Threw them up in my dean's face. Now, you talk about some, people talk about it, we can ask some crazy questions now. No, when we were young in this teaching, we asked crazy questions. And had to have a whole lot. Not to put me down, but he saw that there was some deficiency. So when you go to the doctor, you got iron deficiency. The vessel was talking about you could have thyroid deficiency. And the physician, are we called metaphysicians? The vessel went through and was saying, under his feet, Yahweh Elohim, under his feet, as it were, paved work of a sapphire stone. That's the one with the beautiful feet. Isaiah had nothing to preach until what? The word with the beautiful feet came unto him. All the rest of them. Ezekiel, and I saw the living creatures, and they had the faces of the this and the that, and then above the living creatures was the likeness of the appearance of the throne, and above the likeness of the appearance of the throne was the likeness of a what? A man. They go, them beautiful feet that Isaiah said, and the word entered to me, and set me upon my feet, then what Ezekiel began to preach. That's the preacher that's going to give you some illumination. Not none of us vessels. We're just used or not used. Read.
But they have not all obeyed the gospel. Mm-hmm. For Isaiah said, Yahweh, who had believed our report?
Who have believed our report? All of this. Who have believed that Yahweh has done these things? If down here at the close of an age, in our heart, we are saying that these are just stories that we could turn our back on, then we just saying that this is fables like the Wizard of Oz. Then that shows what's in your heart, who's taken up in your heart and in your mind. Because Yahweh has created a whole creation, we say, to do what? Reflect himself. All of this does what? Reflect himself. So that it's just like you at we don't know how what's in the men's dressing room, but in the women's dressing room, we've got a three-way mirror. We can get front. We can get side, and then when we look in this one, we look back there, and we can get back. And one that reflections, you're going to see you as you really are and as you actually exist. I hope somebody got something out of this, and want to thank the brethren for encouraging us, and some longtime brethren have called and asked us to bring back some of the ones that they heard from Speak the Truth. So we're going to try to make more, not to glorify ourselves, but that through our witnessing, we're letting Yahweh know that we're standing strong. Father, we have not forsaken this great calling that you have given us. With these words, I thank you.
Hallelujah. This ends, concludes our class for today. Let us stand by doxology. Our doxology is taken from Jude, verse 24-25. This is the Holy Name Bible. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time and now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.